For the past 8 years or so, I've been working on focusing on static analysis. And one of the things that originally we were sort of figuring out, the whole point was to find bugs, but actually, you know, we can't find all the bugs because we don't have a full specification of what the program is trying to do. But we know some of the things it's not trying to do, and we also think there's a certain amount of information we can provide to the programmer that might be useful to help them find bugs by doing code reviews. So first of all, we have to know, who has ever done a code review? Anybody in this room? Okay. And did you enjoy it? There we got one or two people. Okay. It can be a very painful process. And so the question is, can you somehow make it less painful? And what I'm going to talk about is how we think a static analysis tool, particularly an advanced static analysis tool, not your average run-of-the-mill static analysis tool, can help in these different areas, which all of are typically quite relevant to doing a really in-depth code review. And then I'll sort of talk, summarize it all at the end there. So as we all know, code review is good for you. Yeah. It's like, you know, brushing your teeth and some of those other things, getting good exercise. But it also can be very painful. Why is it good for you? Well, it finds bugs earlier in the life cycle. As we all know, they get more and more expensive every week, every month they sit in the code. They just get, bugs get more expensive. So if you can find them earlier, everybody's happier. The other thing that it does is it helps build the team, builds knowledge across the team, gets people helping each other instead of having, well, this is my piece of code and don't you ever look at it, and it's, you know. It generally makes people less, let's say, lowers the ego level and generally improves the knowledge. But it can be awfully slow, and it's hard sometimes to convince yourself this is really a productive use of my time. These guys know what they're doing, I'll let them program, I'm not going to go and bother them. Of course, when you finally do it, you say, wow, that was useful, but oh, it was painful. So we're trying to help automate some of the parts of it that make it tedious. So what does an advanced static analyzer do? Well, it does a lot what a compiler does, partly because most of them are built on a very similar technology. Particularly the part of the compiler that understands the dynamic semantics of the program and then also tries to optimize the code it would be generating. The optimizer does what's typically called control and data flow analysis, where it's trying to follow the way that control flows through the program, and then within that control flow, how the data, how the variables are combined, passed on to other variables, and so on. It's doing all of that, a typical compiler, because it thinks it'll allow it to improve the code it generates. But we're doing it because we think it's interesting. We really want to understand exactly what this program is trying to do. Having done all that, we then try to model or simulate exactly what values every variable could hold at any moment in the program. So if you point to a place in the program, well, there's an x. What are the possible values x could say have? Well, you could say, well, what's its type? It's integer. Fine. Minus 2 to the, you know, 31st to plus 2 to the 31st. That's not very helpful. Is that really the range of x at that point? Chances are it's much narrower than that. And if you can do more analysis to figure out exactly what that range is that x has at that point, then you can find out whether if you then add it to y, there's a possibility of a numeric overflow. A lot of programmers don't even think about numeric overflow when they're writing their code. And there are a lot of languages which pretend like it never happens. Java, it's one of the few places where it doesn't throw an exception. It just, well, numeric overflow, that never happens. You know, you got 32 bits, what more do you need? And so that's just one of the kinds of things that you're worried about. I kind of think of programs being built out of fundamentally flawed building blocks, because almost every one of those little building blocks, which we would call instructions, are not complete total functions. They only work if the inputs satisfy certain requirements, like they can't add up to more than 2 to the 31st, for example, or you should get overflow, or the pointers have to be, data has to be initialized, you can't index out of an array. There's a lot of things, or almost at every instruction in the code, it could go wrong if the inputs are not correct. So that's why you want to know exactly what are the values, and do they satisfy the requirements for that particular instruction. Once you know that, you can figure out all the places that any runtime failure could occur. And also, you can then sort of back calculate, okay, well, you're adding X and Y here, that implies that if they are our inputs, that puts some restraints on what those inputs can be. So you can essentially go backwards through a program, figuring out what are the input requirements if you want it to not overflow or not index out of an array or not use a null pointer or uninitialized memory or something. All of those things allow you to turn around and say, well, what's true about the inputs? And then once you know what the inputs can be, then you can also simulate what could the outputs be. Another very important thing in especially in today's world, we have multi-core processors or just multiple processors. Can you determine the threading structure of the program that's been written? And from that, can you then determine whether there are any possibilities of race conditions due to inadequate synchronization and so on? All of these things, it's in there in the code. That's one of the things interesting about software, is that everything is in the code. Everything is machine readable. There's no reason why you can't analyze the heck out of this thing and tell you whether this is a good program or a bad program. It's a little hard to do that with a car. Someone drives up a car, okay, what are we going to do? Take pictures of it or say, wow, that's cool, looks nice. With software, there's no reason you can't actually determine mechanically whether this is a good program or a bad program. So if we can learn all those things, can we help the code review process? Because that's sort of what code review is all about. Is this a good program or is this a bad program? Does it do what it's supposed to do or does it do something relatively unrelated to what it's supposed to do? Okay. And for example, does this go forward when I push the button? Yeah, there you go. So inputs and outputs. I mean, what could be more fundamental? But if you look at a piece of code, is it always obvious what all the inputs are? Well, okay, we got the parameters. That's a good start. But if you've ever done anything with Spark, you know, well, what about all those data items that are kind of coming in from the ether? All those globals or pointers that point off into who knows where and you know, which of this giant graph of data are you actually reading from? You've got a potentially very large amount of things that you might want to know, well, what are the inputs to this piece of program? It's a very, very basic question. It's not that easy to determine just by staring at code. You can spend an awful lot of time, you know, paging through your listings or, you know, scrolling on your screen and so on, just to figure out, well, what are the inputs to this routine overall? That is, yeah, I can look at these lines, but it calls other things which call other things which call other things. What are the inputs? Well, that's something that a static analysis tool can do pretty easily. So what's an example of what it can do? It can annotate a listing, for example, something as simple as random. Well, it's not obvious from the parameters that it has any inputs at all. But if it doesn't, the chances are it's not going to be a very interesting function. So obviously it does have some inputs. And what are those inputs? Well, a static analysis tool can tell you, well, it's got this thing we call the seed, and it's reading that. That's one of its inputs. And surprisingly, it's also its output. And of course, the other output is the result of calling this function. So, you know, well, that's interesting, and probably most people would guess that that's the result. But if you take another piece of code that is of any length, just coming up with that is a good start for a code review. I mean, that's typically what you say, well, what are the inputs and the outputs to this piece of code? Well, let's find out what the truth is, not what the documentation says, which is often not a complete, perfect representation of the truth. Okay, another area very relevant to real-time systems is how about dynamic memory allocation? How many objects are being created by this piece of code? Okay, we know there's some inputs, there's some outputs, but what are you allocating any memory? Any new objects being created out of whole cloth? Again, one of those things that can be painful because, again, it means you have to look down, this calls A, calls B, calls C. Somewhere down there, it's allocating some memory. How much memory might it be allocating? Can you have any way of estimating the total number of objects that are created by this operation, for example? So static analysis tool can go through and find out, okay, well, we found a dynamic allocation point here, and it's inside a loop. So the total number of objects being created is not static. It's actually, you can't actually bound it. It's determined by some piece of the program.